everyone, this is Pico Entertainment and we are back again, and here now we have another video for you, and we're going to talk about Star Trek Discovery as an entire series. Where did it go right and where it went wrong in trying to represent Star Trek for modern day audiences? Now there'll likely be spoilers throughout for the entire series, so just beware when going into this overall video. So in talking about Discovery, we go back to 2015, where CBS Studios announced a continuation of the long-running Star Trek franchise and what would be the seventh television series after, of course, the original series, The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, Voyager, and Enterprise. Discovery would end the 10-year wait from when Enterprise concluded back in 2015. The show was created by both Brian Fuller and Alex Kurtzman, Fuller of whom was the executive producer for both Deep Space Nine and Voyager. Now, Fuller left during production of the first season and was replaced by Gretchen J. Berg and Aaron Harberts. Alex Kurtzman took over showrunning duties from season 3 onwards. Intended to propel the CBS All Access streaming service, Star Trek Discovery debuted on that platform on September 24, 2017, with its first season consisting of 15 episodes. Armed with a huge budget and modern state-of-the-art effects, it promised to be the most largest scale of all Star Trek series so far. The concept being that this would be a prequel story set 10 years before the original series within the 23rd century. The story itself would follow Starfleet Commander Michael Burnham of the USS Shenzhou after disobeying her captain's orders and attacking a Klingon vessel unprovoked. This results in her captain being killed. For her actions, Burnham is court-martialed and sentenced to imprisonment for her mutiny. After Kamen attack during her prison transfer, she is rescued by USS Discovery, where Captain Lorca recruits her after learning of her skills. Over the course of the story, we see Burnham progress through the ranks, carrying out her redemption to regain favour within Starfleet through various endeavours. The finale of the second season saw a major turning point with the Discovery crew travelling 900 years into the future, following the Red Angel signals. This was a deliberate move by the showrunners to free themselves from the constraints of operating as a prequel where they had to adhere to established canon. This would give them a blank canvas to tell newer storylines set within the 32nd century. Now, subsequent stories would see Burnham continue her rise through the ranks to eventually become captain of Discovery. The crew would go on to deal with massive events such as the burn, which disarmed most of the galaxy dilithium, and another space anomaly in the fourth season, which also causes huge destruction within the galaxy. The series would adopt a more serialized structure, very similar to the latter seasons of Deep Space Nine. Despite having some standalone installments, the show's episodes would be linked to dealing with the crisis of the current season. Now, initially within its first season, the show did draw a lot of praise for its large scale and effects, genuinely satisfying both critics and audiences. But as the show went on, it did incur far more stronger criticism, with many hardcore Trek fans feeling that the series sacrificed the more utopian and exploration themes of the show in favour of spectacle, effects and violence. The lead character Michael Burnham especially drew criticism from many online fans, believing her to be far too competent and yet another example of the all too dominant female lead character in modern day entertainment. So when we look back at the series overall, we ask the question, did Discovery come anywhere close to being a compelling science fiction series, and B, a worthy continuation within the iconic Star Trek franchise? Well, if I had to sum up Discovery as a series, I'd say overall it was indifferent. At times it would provide a certain level of visual spectacle and excitement, but from a storytelling perspective, it never truly compelled you with its ideas or concepts, which a lot of the time felt derivative rather than interesting or compelling. Now, once more on the positive side, the show's biggest strength was the special effects and scale, of which each episode had a budget roughly of around $8 million per installment, and this is what you'd expect of such high production value. And certainly with season 1, I was genuinely surprised and quite pleased in how cinematic the show looked in terms of all of the spaceship battles and designs. Now, Star Trek really hadn't had this eye-catching spectacle, not since Deep Space Nine, where we focused particularly on its Dominion War arc. And at the very least, Discovery was a fantastic series to look at on the screen. The idea of having the lead character having to redeem and rebuild themselves from a truly low position was a novel approach, as normally the lead character is already an established commander or captain. In theory, Burnham's journey should have been very powerful and ultimately satisfying. And I would say at least the cast of actors are very likeable in terms of their personalities, and they certainly give their all in terms of the material that they're given. In terms of the characters, I will continue to maintain that Sari, played by Doug Jones, was overall the best character. He certainly had that dignity and integrity and poise that you'd want to expect from any established character of Star Trek. And Doug Jones himself played them with great sincerity, and he really should have been the captain throughout the entire show. But for all of its merits, we do then have to focus on the many issues of the series, which very much denied it of becoming the truly great show that it had potential to be. And in terms of this, we have to focus very much on the concept and the approach. It's true that each episode plays like a mainstream blockbuster movie, not only in terms of the visuals, but also in terms of the tone and the pacing. At many times, the show moves at a million miles an hour with all of the quick edits, the heavy musical score, all of the lens flare and the quick cuts. And at times the story became redundant as you lose sight of what's going on, and again, you become indifferent in terms of the overall story. Now, this approach was clearly intentional by the showrunners to try and make Star Trek much more mainstream appealing. That mindset was the same that we saw also with the J.J. Abrams reboot movies from 2009. But that basic approach means that you do sacrifice the depth and nuance in your storytelling, and everything just feels overall disposable. We do then have to talk much more from the purist Trek perspective, whereas throughout the various movies and series of the franchise, you always felt that there was far more depth, something far more thematic and idealistic within the show or the movies. But Discovery overall just felt very empty. As mentioned, we had the typical crisis of each season, whether it was the Red Angel signals from season 2, the Burnham from season 3, or the Space Anomaly from season 4. And overall, this was just very bare bones narrative, just very one note ideas with very little substance. It all pales in comparison to the antagonists and villains that we got from the best examples of Star Trek. And for all of the resources and budget, we never truly felt that we were exploring the universe and different parts of the galaxy, or indeed encountering new or different races or species, nowhere near that what we got to, for example, with Deep Space Nine. But we never got that same expansion despite the jump forward to the future in season 3, and overall it felt very disappointing to not see this potential fully realised. We do then have to talk about the most divisive and most contentious element of the show, and unfortunately it is the lead character in Michael Burnham. Now, don't get me wrong, I absolutely love actress Sonequa Martin-Green. She's very beautiful, she's stunning in terms of her personality and her brightness and her energy. And she definitely gives her all in terms of her enthusiasm and energy to the role. But in an era where today the concept of the over-dominant female character, the so-called Mary Sue, the woman who's the key to everything, so much of this is discussed in modern-day entertainment today, unfortunately, Michael Burnham fits that criteria 1,000%. Now, whilst the lead character of any Trek series was integral, of course, to the story, Michael Burnham is pivotal to almost any storyline throughout the series. Whether it was instigating the red signals in season 2, into constantly having all of the answers, talking over her superiors, opposing authority and protocols left, right and centre, her presence is just too central to the point where both the story and supporting characters are compromised as a result. In the beginning, I think they got her character right, as again, she was very flawed and vulnerable, but also resilient at the same time. But once she rises through the ranks and eventually becomes captain, which again, I don't think she never deserved, it just felt that she was carrying too much weight in terms of the show's direction. Now, whilst we get plenty of involvement in terms of Michael, the other supporting characters in terms of Stamets, Colbert, Tilly, we just never get the chance to really cut deep enough into their personalities as characters. Even more stately personalities such as Admiral Vance or President Lara Rilak sadly have very little weight or substance, and once more they tend to be overshadowed by Michael's presence. We even look at Book, who they tried to make much more involved with his empathic abilities, and his story really should have ended in season 4 with a much more harsher imprisonment. Overall, he just feels like a supporting love interest for Michael. And again, when you compare to the previous versions of Star Trek, where you look at how rich and developed and also iconic many of the characters were, especially when we look at the original series and also the Next Generation, again, it just leaves a disappointing feeling in terms of what could have been. But we then move on to the series finale itself, which saw the Discovery crew defeat the Breen to access the vital space technology that they had been searching for the entire fifth season. Now, once that crisis is solved, we then see the Discovery crew all happy as Saru gets married. We then jump forward in time, seeing an aged Michael Burnham, who has now assumed the rank of Admiral, living with Book, happily married, as they see their son himself has become captain within Starfleet. Michael then surveys the reconstruction of Discovery one more time before sending the ship on another mission driven by its AI. And overall, this was a conclusion that wasn't bad, but I think surmised Discovery as an entire series, in the sense that it was functional without any impact, existent without any resonance, less iconic and impactful, and much more indifferent. Now, whilst the Star Trek franchise has had varying degrees of quality and success, you always felt that there was some weight and substance, but Discovery ultimately felt much more like a streaming product, an attempt to have a much more commercialised IP, which is apparent, of course, with all of the various spin-offs that we're seeing currently now with the likes of Star Trek Lower Decks. We had, of course, Star Trek Picard and Star Trek Strange New Worlds. We'll shortly see a further extension of this, of course, with both Star Trek Academy and a long protracted development, finally, of the Section 31 series. But Star Trek has never been just a commercialised IP. It's managed to connect with fans as really a symbol of intelligent science fiction, challenging its audience with themes, ideas, and deep concepts. But this is where ultimately Discovery just failed to succeed in. It didn't manage to capture the true essence of what Star Trek represented, and it ultimately divided the hardcore fans. But when we look at it also as an individual series, it was just overall a standard science fiction show with high production values, impressive effects, operating at a big budget blockbuster pace and aesthetic, but ultimately it proved to be no more than that. So those are my overall thoughts and feelings and overall series review of Star Trek Discovery. Let me know what you think in the comments below. And if you have any other movies, television series, or any more issues within the pop entertainment and culture scene that you'd like to see me cover within the channel, then also let me know within the comments and I will see if I can provide further commentary for you on that subject matter within the future. Please also hit and like the subscription and notification buttons so I can provide you with more high quality content like this in the future. But that's it for now. Take care of yourselves and I will see you very, very soon.